Everyone, welcome to Virtual Veg Fest Live. We are sponsored by the Plant Based Network, and this is our Thursday edition. It feels like I haven't been on in ages, and it was just a week. So let's say thank you to Living with Harmony, our special sponsor this week, and to Hodo Foods for sponsoring this month, which is pretty awesome. They're really happy with the fact that everyone is following their social media because, you know, they're donating their prize packs to us, and that's something you can really do. Go to virtualvegfest.com and click on the contest tab, and you can enter to win a prize pack from Follow Your Heart, Hodo Foods, or Gain, and Crafters Organics. And we really appreciate them donating those prize packs monthly for us so that you can win them. And you can win them doing something as simple as subscribing to our Virtual Veg Fest YouTube. Just do it through the contest, and in about 6 days or 7 days, I'm going to, you know, pick a winner, four of them, actually. Oh, hello. Hello, Ramzan and Shafiq. Thank you for joining us live. So, just so you know, if you have any questions or comments, make sure you put them in the little box. And we have Dr. Akhtar today. And, oh boy, okay, we might have some spam today. So, we'll do that. Let's, like, get going because we have a lot to talk about. And one thing I want to direct everyone to as we move through this conversation is a TED Talk that was done in 2014 that all of you need to watch after this. But let's go, like, let's start this. Hey, how are you?
Hey, Helene, how are you?
I'm doing well. I'm really glad that you're here and we get to do this live, as opposed to, like, in person at an event, which I didn't mention. Like, you've been a speaker at Edison Vegan Fest, and I saw you at the Atlanta Veg Fest. I didn't get to, I wasn't your MC in Atlanta, but I saw you in the hall. So it was really, it's always nice to see you. And I'm excited for you to share who you are and about the Center for Contemporary Sciences, about your cats, about your artwork, about just about everything, your books. There's so much. So I'm going to throw this at you so you can tell people who you are.
Okay. So I'll give kind of professional, quick little professional background. So I'm a neurologist and a public health specialist. I'm the president and CEO of the Center for Contemporary Sciences, which is a new nonprofit organization that was launched just in May of 2020. So we're quite new, but our goal is to replace animal testing with much better testing methods that are going to really help us understand human health and come up with therapies for our diseases in a much better way than animal testing is doing currently. So it's our goal really is a win-win for both humans and animals. But before that, I was the deputy director of the Army's Traumatic Brain Injury Program. And then before that, I worked for 10 years at the Food and Drug Administration, and most recently in the Office of Counterterrorism and Emerging Threats. And so I always say that's my by day I was a mild-mannered government employee, but by night I was an animal advocate. So even throughout my career, I've been and since I was a child in high school, I've been a devoted animal advocate. I care deeply about how we treat other animals. And I personally love animals. And so I've worked on so many different issues throughout my life. But one of the main things I do is really to use my medical and my public health knowledge to really showcase how basically what's good for animals is what's good for humans. And that by not eating animals, or at least eating fewer animals, by ending the wildlife trade, by, you know, having better ways to look for violence against animals, and by ending animal experimentation, actually all of those things will improve human health. And I really have spent a long time speaking and writing about how the more we treat animals better, the more we treat them as sentient beings in their own right, how not only does that help the animals, but help us as well.
Yeah, well, thank you for your service. So I want to start there. And there's just so much to unpack. I would love for you to talk a little bit about your TED Talk from 2014. And, you know, okay. I see your kitty cat. So, I mean, you're right. So one of the things, if you haven't watched it, I put the link in the comments. So if anyone wants to go watch it, it's about 14 minutes, like 12, 13 minutes of your time, well worth the time to go and watch. And especially if you have cats and dogs and you're not vegan or vegetarian, I highly recommend you go watch it. So I'd love for you to talk a little bit more about how you did that. Were you vegan in the military? When did that start for you? I mean, there's so much.
Sure. So I actually did not grow up vegetarian or vegan. My family is from Pakistan, and traditionally, it's not been a culture that's really been very thoughtful towards other animals, although that is changing more and more, which is nice to see. So we ate animals, and then, but when I was in high school, my family came across information about how animals are treated in factory farms and in the whole food production system. And we actually went vegetarian together and then later vegan. So when I did do the TED Talk in 2014, yes, I was definitely a vegan. It was just a way for me to try to bring out a message to a community which probably hasn't heard this, about how our treatment of animals does impact our own well-being, our health as well. And so in the TED Talk, I really stress the many different ways human health and animal welfare are interconnected. But I do stress a lot of that TED Talk on pandemic potential. So I focus a lot on how the wildlife trade, of which these live animal markets, where we suspect the coronavirus emerged in China, is just one end result of the wildlife trade. And I also talk about how animal agriculture really truly do increase our risk for infectious diseases. And I foretold at that time that, you know, because of these industries, we are going to see a pandemic emerge. And I wasn't the only one, of course. There are many scientists who've been trying to say, look, we've got to really take a look at how we're treating other animals. It's really driving our risk for infectious diseases. They're not the only cause of infectious disease rise, but they're a significant contributing factor. So, of course, here we are today in the midst of a pandemic. It's frustrating because, like I said, I and many other scientists have been trying to say, look, we know a pandemic is coming, and our public health agencies kind of turned a blind eye to this, and that's really frustrating. And unfortunately, I know people don't want to hear this because we're all, I think, facing pandemic fatigue, including myself, but because we really haven't changed, even this pandemic has not led to a change in how we treat animals. And so, unfortunately, we are likely going to see pandemics again and again and again. And there's a very real potential for a much worse pandemic than what we're facing today.
I mean, it's scary to think you're saying a much worse pandemic when we're approaching 600,000 people that have died that we know of, because they're part of statistics. But there's probably a significant number of people that died and weren't even diagnosed with COVID because, you know, it's too late, or by the time they got tested, it didn't show up in their blood anymore, but they have everything that comes with COVID, whether it be a stroke, heart disease, the brain aneurysms, kidneys shutting down. I mean, there's so many things that are impacted with COVID. And you're right. This wasn't enough to make change happen, right? I mean, really? How hard do you need to be hit in the head to facilitate change so that you don't lose over half a million people of your society just this one country, let alone all over the world, right?
Right.
But I'm not worried about the other countries. I'm worried about the one I live in at the moment, and that they just...
You can see my cat in the background. Yeah. So you're right. But pandemics are global. And so what happens in one part of the world, as we have seen, definitely affects us here. So we always have to be thinking about global solutions, global preventative measures. And I apologize if the camera was kind of shaking. One of my cats is going all excited, just playing and kicking the back of the table legs and everything. So that is Nessie that you're seeing in the background. It is very frustrating. And yes, the pandemic has caused enormous suffering in humans. And the reason why this is not the worst pandemic we're going to get is because still, although this has been a virus that's incredibly contagious and it's spread very quickly around the globe, its lethality rate in general is not as high as many viruses have been that we have seen. So the coronavirus kills about 2 to 3% of people who catch it. But we have seen viruses, avian influenza, H5N1, which is a highly pathogenic avian influenza coming out of animal agriculture, and other types of viruses coming out from the wildlife trade that have a lethality rate of 50, 60, even 70%, meaning 60 or 70% of the people who get those viruses will die from those viruses. So we've been lucky, though, in the fact that so far those viruses have not been very contagious among humans. But those viruses are still out there. They are roaming the globe, and they are ever mutating. So
it's perfectly fine.
Nessie is a frequent, she frequently shows up on my video podcast now and or any video interviews now. So she's going to become famous. I love that girl so much. What I was saying was the viruses are out there. They're still mutating. The problem that we have with viruses is that they mutate at a rate that we can't even compare with. I mean, so they mutate, and I'm trying to remember the statistics, and I can't. But they mutate at an incredibly rapid rate, and each time they mutate, that means that they have a potential for mutating their genome and mutating into a form that could be deadlier or could be more contagious. And so that's the fear we have with all these viruses that are out there that we've already seen, and viruses that we have yet to see. But I guarantee they're out there. We just haven't detected them yet.
Yeah, it's really scary. I mean, this whole thing for me was scary to start with. I took it very seriously from moment one, and still take it seriously even as a person that has been vaccinated. It just I go back to how could you not want to change your behaviors when the potential risk for future, and you're right, you were saying the things about those other viruses, the saving grace of those more deadly viruses, they were harder to catch. But I mean, we don't know when the deadly virus and easy to catch are going to come together. We don't know if this virus, if we still continue to do the wrong things and let it mutate, as it is, because people aren't taking it seriously, and it just keeps spreading and mutating and becomes that catch it easily, kill you easily. I mean, yeah. Will you stop your behaviors then?
It's very frustrating, and I put a lot of the blame on our media, which has not been wanting to really address how these pandemics are arising, these infectious diseases in general are arising, and how we can prevent them. And of course, I put it at the hands of our public health institutions. I mean, I worked I worked in the Office of Counterterrorism and Emerging Threats preparing for pandemics like this. And yet, not once in with all the other public health organizations I collaborated with, not once did we ever discuss where these pandemics are coming from and how to prevent them from coming. Our efforts were really on what vaccines and what drugs do we need for our strategic national stockpile? You know, what, how do we make sure we're prepared when a pandemic arises, not how do we prevent a pandemic from arising in the first place?
I've always been a fan of being proactive. It really helps when you produce events, you're proactive so that the day of the event or the weekend of the event, things go smoothly. The reason things go smoothly is because you prepare ahead of time. As everything unfolded, I was like, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to prepare to do the things, even as it was happening, to help to make things better. As an organizing person of events, I was like, this you, we can do better. We can totally do better, but we didn't. And there's other reasons for that, right? So I'm really glad we're talking about this because it's still incredibly important, as with the fatigue and people just wanting to, summer's coming, spring's here, it's beautiful outside. And people want to get out of their houses and they still don't want to wear masks. And they're like, I'm vaccinated. And you still have to wait 2 weeks after you're vaccinated and you still have to wear a mask. And what do you know as a doctor and who's educated in this? You're vaccinated, you're wearing a mask. How much risk do you think there is after someone's vaccinated to spread to someone who's not? I feel confident that I'm not going to die and I'm not going to get seriously ill. I feel like I could get the flu.
Right. I can't quantify it. I mean, we don't even have that information from the public, from our institutes, which are studying these vaccines. They don't even have that information for us. I will say, in general, the risks are pretty low. Now, there's a caveat, is that we know that the coronavirus is out there and it's mutating. And so, you know, these vaccines that we have now were developed to target the original coronavirus strain that we saw. So a lot is still unfortunately up in the air as far as how well these vaccines will be against any new variant that's emerging. And so it's going to be really one thing we can do to help prevent new variants from emerging is to try to get vaccinated, to wear masks, to limit the spread of the vaccine, I mean, of the virus, because as I mentioned before, the more the virus spreads, whether it's in humans or whether it's in other animals, the more chances it has to mutate into different strains. And I will say, you know, one of the other things that's come out about from the pandemic is a concerted effort on the part of animal experimental groups and pro lob animal experimental lobbying groups to really increase funding and use of animal testing for vaccines. They've been exploiting the public sphere about the pandemic to try to get more money into animal testing and trying to argue that they need a monkey stockpile, if you can imagine that. And so it's really disheartening to think that, you know, you think about that we have. We're suffering from this vaccine, I mean, from this pandemic, because of how we treated animals. And then we cause further animal suffering to try to alleviate our own suffering. And it's not even the best way. And so at the Center for Contemporary Sciences, we've been trying really hard to react and proactively change how that narrative. I mean, so the original narrative is from these animal experimental groups is human health depends on animal testing. Do you care about humans or do you care about animals? If you care about humans, then you have to care, then you have to be pro animal, you know, testing. But we know actually that the science says otherwise. And so what the science is showing, that animal experimentation as a whole is incredibly ineffective in helping us understand what's happening in the human body and how human diseases originate and evolve and how to combat these diseases. And so, this is a statistic that is often used again and again, but it's a very telling statistic. About 90 to 95% of all the drugs and vaccines that pass animal tests, that are found to be safe and effective in animal tests, as well as some other types of testing, like traditional in vitro testing. These are like traditional cell type of testing methods that are done in the lab. But about the animal tests have often been used to be considered the pivotal tests in this process. So what we can say is that about 90 to 95% of the drugs and vaccines that are found safe and effective in animal tests actually fail in clinical trials. So they fail when they're tried in humans. And most of the reason why they fail is because they're found to be ineffective and or unsafe in humans. So it's a glaringly telling statistic about how poor animal testing is in predicting what we're going to see in humans. So there's a real need for a complete overhaul of the entire system, the entire medical research system, not only out of compassion for animals, so not only out of ethics for the animals' well-being, but also for our own well-being.
So, I have family that has a product that uses snakes. And the product that's produced had to go through animal testing. And of course, it's hard for me to hear when I'm sitting there and we're talking about this, and the person on the other end is a science person and says, well, you have to do animal testing. Because, first of all, the government requires it, and you can't get your product to the consumers without it, because it's required. So how do you leap that hurdle? I mean, you talk about things like Beyond Meat and Impossible Meat, and the fact that they had to do some animal testing to get the end product to the consumer, and as much as that potentially makes the product not vegan, it's still, I understand why it happened. I don't like the fact that the animals had to go through something like that, but I also believe the end benefit from having a product like that outweighs, way far outweighs, the animals that were sacrificed in a sense to bring it to market, because there's so many omnivores that are eating a plant-based burger because of that being on the menu in mainstream restaurants. I mean, so many more animals are saved for the few that aren't. It's like, it's like in war. Some these people died so that a whole country could be saved. It's not great, it's not wonderful, but it's kind of like what happens. And but how do you counter that? How do I sit there and counter, like, you can't even argue, like if I'm gonna bring this unbelievable thing to the market that's gonna like do this great thing, but I have to have animals suffer for it to happen, because that's what a government says has to happen.
Right. And so, yes, the Food and Drug Administration, which oversees drug and vaccine development and some other types of medical therapeutics, including devices, currently does require animal testing in almost every case, with a few exceptions. That's not scientifically based. That requirement on the part of the Food and Drug Administration is not scientifically based. In fact, there was a recent report that came out from the UK from a large bioindustry group that really called for a focus away from animal testing and a focus on studying human biology because of the incredible high failure rate in drug development. The high failure rate in drug development because, and they specifically stated, because animal testing is ineffective. So that system needs to change. For now, the system is in place, and yes, the Food and Drug Administration still requires animal testing. I worked there for 10 years. They are a government bureaucracy like any other government bureaucracy. They cling to the old because that's what they're used to. And so it's incredibly hard and to have things change, and things change very slowly. But I will say that there are some glimmers of change that's happening, and that we are seeing many more like this new, you know, new really kind of just amazing report that just came out, calling for switch towards testing methods that are based on human biology for drug development. There was a recent drug that was went through development and testing without using animals in Israel, which made a lot of splash in the media. And just last year, the Environmental Protection Agency, which had also required animal testing for all the chemicals that we use out there, issued a mandate to phase out all testing on mammals by 2035. So that's causing a lot of change within the chemical industrial world as well, and causing them to move away from animal testing. So the reason, you know, we know there is a sound scientific reason to not be doing animal testing. Not if the intention is to study human health. We need to focus on studying human biology. And so, yeah, that your family and friends' products may have used animals, have been tested on animals, but that's not because they should have used animals or should have been tested on animals. That's just because of government bureaucracy. But that's going to change because the science is showing that it needs to change.
Do you have any idea, like, and I know it's a slow turning wheel, will we see that in our lifetime?
That's our goal at Center for Contemporary Science, is to make that an achievable goal in our lifetime. You know, if anyone wants to help us, we could definitely use the help. So you can find out about our organization at it's called the Center for Contemporary Sciences, www.contemporarysciences.org. I should know my own organization's URL. I think that's it. but it's our goal. And I actually, if you had asked me this 10 years ago, I would not have been as optimistic. But today I'm optimistic that we actually can achieve that goal, at least in the United States and in, and I would say in some European countries. I think we have a real opportunity to really fundamentally change how medical research is conducted. And again, that will be for the betterment of animals and humans. Now, elsewhere in other countries like China, which tends to be behind in this respect, I think it may take longer to see that kind of change.
Well, that's incredible. So, I mean, I kind of understand why you started the Center for Contemporary Sciences, right? I mean, how are you doing what you're doing to help make this change happen?
Mm-hmm. We like to call ourselves as a bridge builder. We're a scientific organization. Yes, we're driven by the passion, the ethics, whether it's on behalf of animals or on behalf of human health. You know, my dad has faced multiple problems which have not been alleviated with the drugs that are currently out there. I want a better medical research system for my dad. I want a better one for my husband, who suffers from multiple spinal injuries. And, you know, so I want better treatments for him. So our goal really is to help drive funding towards the companies and the academic institutions that are creating these new testing methods that are based on human biology, to drive investment towards those companies and into those techniques, to raise awareness among scientific organizations and groups, because even though there are many testing methods out there now that are based on human biology, they're not being used as well as they should be, or not being used at all. So we are there to help raise awareness among researchers to hopefully get increased the use of these technologies. We want to foster the next generation of scientists to work with academic institutions to train biomedical students in these new technologies as opposed to training in animal testing. And they want to train in these new technologies, but there are not as many academic programs that really teach them about these alternatives to animal testing. So there are multiple ways. We're hosting many scientific workshops, a series of scientific workshops this year to really bring together to put together a very collaborative effort to show how can we use these new testing methods to really understand our four key areas for this year at least. And so we identified Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, carcinogenicity, which is cancer testing for chemicals, and for vaccine development. So we're working on multiple fronts to really bring together a very collaborative effort across institutions.
I mean, can you imagine? I mean, so many people. I bet every person who watches this knows someone who's been impacted by cancer, diabetes, strokes, heart disease. I mean, every single one. Imagine if we had a system where when the doctor hands you that drug, it actually works without severe amounts of side effects because it was tested in a way that it was for our bodies. Not that drugs, I'm not a huge fan of handing a pill over. I mean, start with plant whole foods, plant-based diet, exercise, possibly losing weight, changing like, you know, how you feel your body should all be a part of the lifestyle and medicine side. But sometimes a pill is needed, right? And imagine if that pill was actually made for humans, on humans, or on human cells, or whatever it is scientifically that will happen, so that you know when I hand this pill to this patient, I kind of know what's going to happen, as opposed to don't really know how this is going to affect you. That's why so many people on the drugs for those types of diseases have so many side effects. Or you listen to the side effects of the drug commercials and you kind of go, who would ever take that? Who would ever
Right.
take that?
Yeah, and that's going to be the future of medicine. I guarantee it. And so we also will be able to really target and create drugs and therapies that are personalized to your biology one day, and personalized to my biology, personalized, you know. So we know that even within our own population, the human species, there's so much variation. What may be safe and effective in you may not necessarily be safe and effective in me. And so with these opportunities to really grow, we're growing human cells in complex 3D structures that really mimic much more greatly than ever before real human physiology. We have a human body on a chip in which you have different human organs interconnected on chips. So you've got, you know, you can really test to see how a drug may work through through all of these different organs, through all these different systems. And we have organoids, which are mini miniature organs that we're actually growing in the lab. They're being 3D printed in the lab. These are human organs that we can test substances on, that we can research it, that we can use to research and investigate how diseases emerge, what's the cause behind different diseases. And with these technologies, we will one day get to a point when we can kind of start looking at subsets within the population, within human populations, so that we can kind of, you know, look at subset or create organs from subsets of the human population and create tissue cultures from subsets so that we can more finely tune how these drugs are going to affect those particular subsets. So this is getting into what we call personalized medicine, where the medicines that are created so that they're more personalized for you as opposed to just the general human population at large. And so there's so many exciting endeavors that are taking place, and there's so many exciting possibilities for what we can do in the future. And you know, at Center for Contemporary Sciences, we're really going to try our best to really help us get there in a much faster way.
That's fantastic. Do you think the word short-sighted comes to mind as you're speaking, but technology is probably a really big part of this. You think going back, we're going back, way back, and they start like, they say, well, we need to test to figure out if these things will be good for humans. You think it was kind of short-sighted to think that they could test on animals in the first place and not actually try and figure out how to do this without animals, because we need to see what happens in humans? And then I go to technology and go, the reason why this will probably all advance in the way that you've stated is because we have the technology now to do that, as opposed to in the beginning, they kind of looked at it and went, oh, look, an ape looks like us. You know, monkeys have the similar systems to us, so let's just test on them. They're not really sentient beings or anything, not like they feel like dogs and cats and bunnies, not like they feel anything. Obviously, I'm being facetious for those who think I'm not.
I think going back, I mean, I can understand from a scientific perspective, not from an ethical perspective, but from a purely scientific perspective, why decades ago scientists thought that, you know, learning from a chimpanzee or a non-human or any other non-human primate's physiology could be applicable to human physiology. I do understand that. And in very broad general areas, there is applicability. There is, overlap and many similarities in how our bodies function. But today we're now looking at the subtle nuances of molecular biology. And in there, there are just so many differences between species. And what I would say is that I think that I believe that we would have been further ahead today. I truly believe that if we had never developed a system that focused so heavily on animal experimentation. I think, you know the saying where there's a will, there's a way. If there was a will to really study human biology and not to keep doing animal experimentation, we would have found ways earlier to really study and understand human biology. Yes, technology today certainly is helping. There is no doubt about it. But I do believe that we would have been further ahead had we not been focusing so much on animal testing in the first place.
That is a great answer. Thank you. And it's a lot of food for thought for everyone out there, especially when the way you can help, as you said in your TED Talk, is to, go out to eat. And as you said, to quote you, order vegetarian. Well, order whole foods, plant-based, order vegan, and you save the planet, you save the animals, and you save your health. It's really simple. The food now will be incredible. Just go somewhere you know it's going to be good, because, there's always that, new place that kind of sucks, and that's their first time trying it, and they're like, this is what I thought it was going to be, and it's like, no, go someplace that everyone raves about and order something familiar, and then eat deliciousness, and then you'll be good. So I really want you to share about your art. You're an incredible artist.
Thank you. I don't know about that, but I have been doing art all my life. I mean, I used to, I was the introverted, oddball, nerdy, weird kid sitting in the class, and I would sit there and draw caricatures of my fellow classmates and teachers. My teachers, I would draw them as spiders hovering over the students and things like that. So I used to doodle a lot, and then it just kind of developed from there. When I was in high school, I started watching Bob Ross, which has seemed to have made a comeback recently. I used to record him on VHS back in the day. For those people who don't know what a VHS was, it is It was our version of the CD. But so I used to record him when on VHS when I was in school, and then come back home, and in the afternoons after school, I would practice painting along with Bob Ross. So that's how I got started, and then I've just been teaching myself. I'm self-taught. I've been doing it all my life, reading lots of books, going to galleries, going to art museums, and just soaking up art around me. So I love it. It's a good balance in many ways to the scientific work I have to do. And I enjoy dabbling in so many different kinds of medium with my artwork as well.
It's really pretty. Is it anywhere outside of being friends with you on Facebook?
So I am actually working on setting up a wait,
Gallery?
profile, or
Oh, a
you call it.
profile. Oh, okay, a page on Facebook.
No, it's not on Facebook. It's going to be on a website called Saatchi Art. I think it's Saatchi Art. So it's for artists to sell their artwork. So I've been a little bit behind in uploading and taking photos of my artwork. So I'll be working on that and trying to sell some artwork, and that helps me with again, that just helps me, makes it so that I can take a lower pay with my organization, which helps the organization. So, but again, I just love doing it. I never actually sold my artwork before. It was never something that I actually had much interest in doing because it's kind of a pain in the neck. I was more interested in just doing the art as opposed to trying to sell it. But I decided to go ahead and switch to trying to sell some of the artwork. So I dabble in pen and ink, in charcoal, in watercolor, in acrylic paints, in oil color, pastels, soft pastels, and oil pastels as well. So I kind of dabble in a little bit of everything out there.
Well, it's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And you run a nonprofit, and a great way to raise funds for your nonprofit is to sell your art. You have it, you see, you're like, I look at it and I go, it's beautiful. I don't have that skill. Like, I can't do what you're doing. I'm not like, I can't draw a straight line person. My appreciation for what your ability is, it's overwhelming, because I think it's I'm just I'm always I've always been amazed by people who are artistic, who can just draw. Even back in elementary school, I remember a girl was like drew something in front of me, and I was like, I could never do that. I was so young, but I still like it. Just it's not you, everyone as you age, you know what you can and you cannot do. I can't do what you're doing, but I really appreciate that you can. And absolutely love it. So the fact that other people will be able to enjoy your art, is fantastic. I'm really glad to hear that.
Thank you so much. That's really good of you.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah, and I was super excited. Matter of fact, I think it was your art that had me go, I need to reach out to her. I need to bring her on, because I knew you existed, but it was like after seeing your art on the timeline, I was like, ah. I need that's what like prompted me to like reach out at that moment. So just it is beautiful. And is that yours above the fireplace?
That's one of mine. My house is every artwork in the house is mine actually. So it might be hard, but that's kind of a tree limb kind of going out laterally. And I don't really do realistic art. It's never been the thing that I've been interested in. I like things a little bit more either impressionistic or expressionistic, which is probably how I would describe my work more. It's and whimsical.
And I also like the fact that you have, normally science people don't tend to go into the realm of the art side. I love the fact that you have this mixing through you, and it's like it's human. It's not that you're not human, but you know what I mean? Like it's like you can relate to so many more people because you have so many different facets to you that it draws people in. And that's important because you have got important things to say.
Thank you so much. I hope so. And I would get bored, to be honest, if I were just doing one thing. And I've written books. Like you said, I've given talks. I dabble in art. I love to garden, except when the mosquitoes are really out there. I love to cook. I'm creating all kinds of meals. I love to make cocktails and come up with my own recipes for cocktails. So I would be so bored if I wasn't always trying to come up with something new. I like to create. So I was really grateful to have this opportunity to really create, going back to the Center for Contemporary Sciences, really create a new, to have an opportunity to really use my imagination in a sense to come up with new ways to create a medical research system that's better for everyone.
That's awesome. That's really awesome. And then you have two cats still?
Yep, I have two cats, a brother and sister pair, Nessie and Tumbles.
Oh, they're like, Nessie is so, so cute because while you were talking, Nessie was actually batting around a little toy earlier on. I love when cats play.
I wish you could have heard her because she makes the cutest noises when she's playing. I know everyone will talk about their own cats and dogs, and I'm one of those people. For people who don't appreciate animals, it'd be so fed up with me how much I could talk about my cats. And Nessie has this squeal that she gives when she's talking, when she's playing with her toys. She talks to her toys all the time. It's really adorable. And her brother Tumbles is, he kind of coos when he's playing.
Oh, I heard Nessie. There was a little bit earlier on yesterday while you were talking. I was like, oh, it is so, so cute. I have two dogs and three cats. So, I'm sorry, two cats and three dogs over here. And they're not in the room because they would be on me while I was doing this. And what's fun about the fact that cats come into view or animals or roosters are crowing is this is a vegan podcast. If you didn't have animals and you didn't appreciate the sounds of them, then you probably wouldn't be on.
I think in general, if you're someone, whether you're vegan or not, whether you care about animal rights, animal protection or not, if you see an animal on a video cast or something and you don't react positively, there's something wrong with you. Honestly, even like my husband, he's with his very serious coworkers. And sometimes our cats are presented whenever he's on a Zoom call with his coworkers. And some of them, are just like, oh, is that your cat? And, or just react in a nice way. And others seem a little, they don't know what to do with it. And I think it's very telling of your personality and how you react to other animals as well. And, be laid back about things. It's great seeing animals on these work Zoom calls. Work Zoom calls are boring as it is. It's nice to have something break that up. Or someone break that up.
Exactly. It's funny. I have a housemate that moved out in December, but when he moved in like 5 years earlier, 6 years earlier, he did not like animals. It's not like he hated animals, but he just never lived with them. So he kind of was like, I'll just coexist with these dogs and this cat, Well, mm-hmm. Fast forward, he grew to love them, absolutely love them, totally gets the value of having cats and dogs and how they love you and you can love them and the relationship you can have with them. Completely changed his whole perspective because he lived with a lot of them over the course of the time.
That happens quite a lot. My husband Patrick, he always would say he was a dog person. And when he first met me, I had Silos, who died a year and a half ago, and he was with us for 20 years. he didn't know how to be around Silas, who was a cat. And you know, he didn't know how to hold him. Silas was wary of him. He was wary of Silas. And in just a short period of time, though, my God, he just so came to love Silas. And he is just so ridiculous about cats now. You know, he's we joke that, but it's true, about 80% of the conversations that Patrick and I have are about Tumbles and Nessie. They're fun to talk about, and we love them so much, and we love talking about them. They're such a just tremendous part of our lives. They're the half of what this family is.
Oh, I know. As you know, that's true. We're probably in the same boat in this house. The three dogs, two cats. The dogs consume a lot of the conversation because some of them just want to be the conversation. I was doing yoga this morning, and you know what it's like to do yoga with three dogs and a cat licking my face, rubbing in between me, just biting, like going on top of me. I'm trying to do bridge pose, and like Marshall's got his hand like on me. I was like, look. And then of course I push him away and he thinks it's playtime. So I'm like, no, it's not playtime, it's bridge time. So yeah, I was a cat person for like most of my life, and then I got a dog. And I flipped to the dog side. And I mean, obviously still love cats. I still have two of them, but dogs stole my heart. And yeah, we could probably go another hour talking about our fur kids and who they are and what they do and how much joy they bring us. And then everyone else would be like, well, my dog, my cat, my bunny, my rooster, my chicken, my goat, and my pig, can't forget pigs, would they have the same stories because they're our kids. They're our babies.
There are kids, they are, but they're, and it's also that they're not humans, and so I think that's what makes them so joyful to be around. You know, they really are. They show us a larger world. Otherwise, we're so human-centric, you know that, and it's good to step out of that kind of world view and see the world through the eyes of other beings. And I think these cats and dogs allow us to do that as well.
Well, that's fantastic. That's a great way for us to go to the question of if someone wanted to reach out to you, how could they? Oh, there's one thing. Stephen Heimowitz actually did make a comment earlier that excessive animal testing is not kind, and for you to keep us informed. He posted a YouTube video, but I don't know what that YouTube video goes to, but I'm guessing it's probably something to do with animal testing. Because I'm not going to click it now. So I just want to reach that. But if someone wanted to reach out to you, donate to you, because I did it, donate to you, how would they do it?
Thank you so much. We could definitely use the help. Thank you so much for the offer. We are the Center for Contemporary Sciences. Let me just double check and make sure I have the right URL. And I'm sure I do. It is. Yep, it's just www.contemporarysciences.org. And there is a donate page there, and there's different ways that you can contact us. On my bio, I have my email there, or we have more general email contacts that you can use.
Right, general on the site. Awesome. And then are you on Instagram? You are on Instagram, but it's not a lot of followers yet. It's Contemporary Sciences, right?
Yeah, we're on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn. We're trying to grow our audience, and we are growing it each day. So, yep. But as I said, we're so new. So please do join us through Instagram and Facebook. We'd love to have you as partners with us.
Oh, definitely. And it's incredibly important because before I was even vegan, as a vegetarian, I was debating animal rights and animal testing, right? So, I mean, that was actually my start. It's an interesting way to start, but I started with understanding cruelty-free and animal testing and PETA and like all that, and I was 19 years old. So, and it's kind of just, you know, you don't lose that as you go through life. You just kind of learn and ebb and flow. But if you're in this world and you've delved into more than health reasons, then you're aware that getting the testing on animals to stop is something that we really need to do, and that all of us need to get behind you and what you're doing. So let's make that happen.
Thank you so much. It's how it really was. Animal testing is really the, especially the issue that's near and dear to my heart, being a scientist and a doctor. It's been something that's resonated with me in a sense, as far as combating it all my life, ever since I started knowing about animal abuse issues and how we treat other animals and animal protection. I think a lot of people historically have gotten into this movement because of animal experimentation. It seems to have gotten less focus now in the movement, but we hope to bring that back up.
Yeah, you're right. It's health has become like probably the thing that trumps everything else at the moment. Like more celebrities, health, you know, when they go vegan, or, you know, even Kamala Harris, you know, vegan before six. Hey, I'll take it, because, you know, wherever you are in your journey is where you are. And the fact that you're even on a path like that is better than not being on it at all. So that's, and then the amount of people that they can reach. But we can't forget about the environment and the animals, in addition to the health reasons. And it just, you know, those seeds just kind of have to get planted in people so that they can sprout when it's time for them to sprout. Because some people go in for different reasons and don't know about the other pieces of that puzzle. But, you know, we help them learn. That's all we can do.
Yep.
Well, thank you so much. This is amazing. You know, like I said, I never know what direction we're going to go, but this was absolutely amazing. So thank you for spending your time with us and sharing all your knowledge and who you are and what you do. And I hope everyone else like really enjoyed it too.
Thank you so much, Helene. And I also wanted to just mention on the pandemics, there is a documentary that's going to be coming out soon. I don't know when. It hasn't been determined yet, but it's called The End of Medicine, and it's by director Alex Lockwood. So do keep an eye on that. That's going to be addressing how our treatment of animals has brought about this pandemic and will continue to increase our risk for infectious diseases.
Oh, that's great. Well, thank you. Do you have any idea when it'll come out or what platform?
It was supposed to come out. I mean, it was supposed to have been done as far as the editing by the end of February, but of course that never works out on schedule. So the goal was to get it out this spring, and on the platform that hasn't been determined yet.
Okay. Are you in it?
I am. Okay, yes.
That's awesome. You definitely let me know when that is, because maybe we can do a streaming of it on the Plant-Based Network.
Okay, great. We're actually CCS, the Center for Contemporary Sciences. We're planning an event around the film as well, as a fundraiser for CCS. So, do look out for that. You can check our Facebook and our other social media sites for updates on that when we do have more information, or just check on our website itself.
Definitely let me know how we can help, because to stream and fundraise in collaboration with the Plant-Based Network, we can help you reach globally.
That would be wonderful. Thank you so much. Yeah. I'll talk to you a little bit more about that then.
All right, that's awesome. Well, have a great rest of your Thursday. And so thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you, everyone who joined us.
Bye. Here we go. I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. That was absolutely incredible and important and valuable information about, you know, COVID and vaccines and viruses and more. I never know where the conversation necessarily is going to go, but I'm glad this one went in the direction that it did. And we got to talk about art, and I promised cats. And of course, the Center for Contemporary Sciences. Please please check all that out. All the notes are in the comments, and of course, they're part of the video as well. Even if you're vaccinated, you still have to wear a mask, right? So we support getting vaccinated with Triangle Veg Fest and Virtual Veg Fest. It's something that we feel like everyone needs to do so we can get back in person and feel safe having an event, which I'm hoping to do this year as well. But please wear your mask over your nose, under your chin. Make sure you cover your nose because if you don't, your nose is connected to your lungs and it renders this useless. So you don't want this to be useless. You actually want to protect yourself and to protect others by wearing it. Even if you're vaccinated, you want to keep that on because, like we just discussed, variants, mutations of a virus, you never know if they're out there. So we want to keep everybody safe and we want to see you the next time that we can get together. In the meantime, if you are so inclined to not dine in a restaurant, and some of the restaurants that are probably more vegan and plant-based minded are probably not going to open up to the public and have you all come in and eat unmasked, probably going to continue with takeout and food trucks and go order takeout, curbside pickup, go to your food trucks and grab some food, help them get through this pandemic so they are there for when we all feel safe, we can go eat. Other than that, guess what's happening on Saturday? Dr. John McDougall will be joining us at 4 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Super excited to have Dr. McDougall on and for all of you to get to know him because he's awesome. And I think you're definitely going to enjoy my conversation because when I said it was just a conversation, he responded with, "Oh, I get to know you too." And that kind of sums up what Dr. John McDougall is like. So that'll be Saturday at 4 p.m. Other than that, subscribe to Virtual Veg Fest on YouTube to help us grow our channel and go into the contest. And we will see you. Don't forget Monday and Wednesdays, we have two new shows, both at 7 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, Kimberly and Coach Kayla, respectively, Monday and Wednesday. Check out their shows too. 20 minutes Q&A about, well, the lifestyle of veganism and about nutrition and veganism, also respectively, Monday and Wednesday. And that, have a great Thursday, and I'll see you on Saturday. Thanks. Bye.